Right, let's start our lecture on electric machines. So today we'll look at the basics of an electric machine. And to make things a bit easy to start up, we'll just explain in terms of the AC machines. And then you realize that the conversion or the change from AC machines to DC machines will become very, very easy, right? So I'll also be recording the video so that we can use it on YouTube. So don't worry about other things. If you go offline or miss it, you still find it on YouTube. It will be there. So for us to just start up and next week, we'll be going to the details of DC machines, the generators and the motors. And after that, we'll also go into the details of AC machines. And lastly, we'll talk about transformers. Then we'll go to special types of machines at a later stage. As you know, we are behind time, so we have to be very fast. But for today, I'll be slightly slow so that we can all be able to deal with that. Right. So we are starting with the introduction. It's TEE2142 electric machines. And today we'll do the basics of electric machines, focusing on AC machines. Like I said, it's a bit easier to understand the concept of machines when you talk about AC machines first. And then, like I said, we'll not go into the neat details of the AC machines because according to the plan, when we go into the details of machines, we'll be looking at the DC machines first. Right, so this is our second lecture. So the electric machines are based on the electromagnetic induction principle. And so if you remember from your TEE2142 or something, the circuit analysis, you realize that we also talk about Ohm's law. We also then talk about Faraday's law. So Faraday's law is the one which is very important as far as electric machines are concerned. And it tells us that when there is a change in flux linked to a conductor, then an EMF will be generated across it. That's basically Faraday's law, if we're not taking it in detail. In other words, you might hear here that if a conductor moves in a magnetic field, then an EMF is induced across it. That's the same thing. Movement will cause the cutting of flux and hence the change of flux linked to the conductor. And that is what causes electromagnetic induction. So once you know Faraday's law, then it means you know how the generator should operate. So it means there should be movement of a conductor in a field so that there is also a change in the magnetic flux linked to that conductor, causing an EMF to be induced. And the magnitude of the generated EMF is directly proportional to the rate of change of flux. That means that's why when a generator runs faster, a bigger EMF is also induced. That is the explanation. And then from our previous lecture, you might also have noticed that we talked about the existence of a magnetic field around a current carrying conductor. So that explains why when you place a conductor which is carrying current, if you place it in, you experience a force. Why? Because the magnetic field of that coil will be interacting with the field of the magnet, and hence there will be a force that is experienced there. And this principle explains the motor principle. That's why a conductor will rotate in a magnetic field to give the motor effect. In the other machine, like I said, which we are going to talk about, are the transformers. Transformers are static machines. That means there's no movements in the transformer. And the generated EMF is due to simple mutual induction. So you realize that there's just movement of flux. And when there's a coil rotation, then you talk about the mutual induction, which operates in the transformers. Right. And if you look at a generator, in simple terms, a generator converts mechanical energy to electric energy. And the conductor is made up of coils which are rotated in a magnetic field. Right? So in this case, the coils are rotated using a prime mover. That's why you need a motor or an engine to turn a generator. And that turning will now cause the conductors to move around the magnetic field. Remember, we said now if your conductor moves around the magnetic field, an EMF is generated in it, and that EMF will come out as the voltage that is generated by your generator. Right? So, like I said, you can use any other system, a mechanical system, to turn the coils of that generator and the EMF produced. So if we go back to electromagnetic induction theory, we said the magnitude of the generated EMF or generated voltage depends on the strength of the magnetic field. That means the strength of the magnet or the magnetic field that is produced in the generator, then the angle at which the conductor casts the flux. So you realize that it's not always that when a conductor moves in a field, it has some voltage generated across it. Sometimes when it is parallel to the field, then there is no generated EMF. So that's why we are saying the angle at which the conductor casts the flux also determines the magnitude of the generated EMF. Then also the speed of the conductor, like we said the rate of cutting of flux is also proportional to the voltage. So that means when the flux is being cut at a faster rate, the magnitude of the generated voltage is also increased. Then the length of the conductor within the field, that just explains the surface that is exposed to the field. And that's what determines.
Ma?
Yeah, a bit, Nico. Can you mute your mic, please? All right. Then the polarity of the induced EMF depends on the direction of the magnetic field and the direction of the movement of the conductor. We explained that using the Fleming's right hand rule, which will tell us the direction of the induced EMF. So the direction of the induced EMF will give you the polarity of the induced EMF. So what are the components of a generator? You might have a field excitation, in which case the stator field will be excited by a a source, like a DC source. Then we also have an exciter rheostat. Then also we have the stator, which is the core. So in the stator, that's where the flux is established. Then we also go on to look at the slip rings, and these are used now to transfer the generated EMF. So we have flux moving around the core, right? So in this case, our fluid will be in that direction. So that will be our direction of the flux, right? Then we also have our brushes, which are used together with the slip rings. So you realize when you talk about slip rings and split rings, that is what will differentiate a DC generator from an AC generator. We'll talk about that later. Then you also have the rotor, in which we now have our coils. So these are the coils. So these are the conductors now, which will be cutting the magnetic field. And in that case, we have a generated EMF as an AC output, right? We'll explain later how we get that AC output to use. So the components of the generator, we have the field, the coils of the conductors receive voltage from a source, that the excitation, and produce a magnetic flux. Then the voltage is now produced in the armature, which is coils, which have large wires to contain the, or to transfer the full load current of the generator output. Then also have the prime mover, which is used to rotate our generator components, that is the coils, so that they are used the prime movers. Then we have the rotor, which is driven by the prime mover. This is where we have our windings for the coils, right? So that's basically what we'll be looking at as the components of our generator, right? Then we also have the stator, which in that case is the core. So this is the stationary part, which can also be either armature or a field. Remember, field, you are talking about the one which produces the required magnetic field in the machine. Then the armature is the one which carries the generated EMF. So you should take note of that. Then also have the slip rings, which transfer power to and from the rotor. Remember, I said the generated EMF will be in the coils. Then for us to drive a load, we need those conductors to transfer the power. So this is electrical connected to the rotor windings, but insulated from the shaft. Remember, I said the rotor is also on the shaft because it's driven by the prime mover. Then we have a magnetic field, which is produced, right? So this magnetic field in our previous diagram is produced by the current. Remember, we talked about the solenoid, whereby you wind coils on a core, then you produce a magnetic field. So in that case, we're using DC to produce the magnetic field, right? Then there's a continuous connection that is given by the brushes, which are put in place or held in place by a set of springs, right? Then we have the conductors, which are now the ones on which the EMF is generated, right? So that's what we have there. But then we said there is a link between the movement of the machine and the direction of the generated current, which in this case we said the polarity of the generated current. So in our case, what we need is the induced EMF, because we are talking about the generator. So from a machine, you know the direction of the field and you know the direction of movement. So let's say you are turning your machine, right, up. I mean, there will be a conductor on this side, right? the conductor is moving up. And let's say your magnetic field is in this direction, right? Then what will be the direction of the current generated in the conductor? So that's where you use the right hand rule, right? Or the generator rule. So if you hold the thumb, the forefinger and the middle finger at 90 degrees to each other, right? That means there will be X, Y, Z plane. Then if the forefinger points in the direction of the magnetic field in the machine, and if the thumb points in the direction of motion of the conductor, then the middle finger will now point in the direction of the induced voltage. That means the direction of the current. Remember, we said current moves from the positive to the negative in the conventional machine. So this would be the direction of our induced current. Right, we will practice that. And remember, the magnitude of the voltage is BLV. B will be the magnetic flux density, that is of this field. Then L will be the length of the conductor, which is crossing the magnetic field. And V will be the velocity or the speed of rotation of your conductor in the field. That gives you the magnitude of the voltage, right? Then the AC generator theory, a simple AC generator consists of a conductor or a loop of wire in a magnetic field. So you might realize that there are some toys which if you turn, they will produce a light and the light. That's the simple concept that you use there. So the two ends of the loop connect to slip rings that are in contact with brushes. So these are our slip rings. Slip ring number one, slip ring number two. This is your brush, and that is also your brush, right? So from the illustration that we gave, then we realized that the current will be flowing in that direction. So the current will come from there. So this becomes your positive at the moment and the negative at the moment. But remember now, this is side AB and this is side CD, right? Because the slip rings are continuously in contact with the brushes. When this side now is on side CD, it means the current flowing inside CD will now be in the opposite direction. Hence, you have an AC being generated. At one point, the current then is due to AB. And at the other point, it's due to side CD and so on. That's why it produces AC, because the conductors will be changing side as the conductor will be rotating in that field, right? So that should make you understand what happened there. So what you need for a simple AC generator is a magnetic field, a conductor, and the relative motion between the conductor and the magnetic field. So the conductor should just cut the flux, then an EMF is induced. That's that symbol, right? So if that is what is happening, you realize that current will be changing direction continuously up and down as the sides of the conductor will be changing. So that is your generator effect. So this rotating part is the one which will be connected to a rotating shaft. So if the shaft is there, maybe you have a diesel engine or whatever you are using there, or a petrol engine to rotate these conductors, then you are generating the AC that you require from your machine. So, like I was explaining, the change in sides, if this is our red side, then this will be another color. When red is to the North Pole, current is flowing through AB in that direction. When red is on the South Pole, current flows through it in that other direction. So you realize that the current will be alternating. If you check closely what is happening there, if you look at these arrows, they're showing you that the current is continuously changing direction, and since we are saying is generating alternating current, which is our AC in that case, right? So in vertical position, the coils are moving in parallel with the field. So if they are in vertical condition, it means in vertical position, it means there is no generated EMF in the what? In the coils. But then as the coil starts to rotate, it starts to increase the angle through which it casts the flux. So from zero up to 90 degrees. So at 90 degrees, when it is perpendicular, then that's where it generates most. So it's zero here, gets to 90 degrees. But then as it continues to rotate, the angle now decreases again and the voltage will also be decreasing. Then as it changes the direction of rotation again from zero to that, it also increases. And then we are generating an AC from that kind of system. So the slip rings will be continuously changing from positive to negative, right? Then the current will increase to a maximum at 90 degrees, like I said. Then the coil will be moving perpendicular to the magnetic field and cast the greatest number of flux, right? So we are saying in that position, it's at zero. At 90 degrees, so it's zero volts there, 90 degrees there, 180 is there, and then at 360 is there. Right, so it makes a complete revolution, and then that is when the current will be changing. So it goes like this, and then it also goes like that in those positions. Right, so if the coil continues to turn, and this voltage also decreases, right? I have explained that. And in the next revolution, again, it does that, but then the polarities will be reversed. Then the current will flow through ARA. It's now X2 to Y. In our diagram, I was explaining between A, B, and C, D. So that is what will be happening in our AC generator. So we want to see now what is the link between the frequency of the generated EMF, the number of poles in the machine, and also the speed of the rotating machine. So when AC generator produces the voltage, current is in step with the voltage. That means current and voltage are the same. If the coil rotates 360 degrees, out voltage goes through one cycle, then the voltage also increases from zero to Emax, decreases to zero, and so on. So the period is the time required for the generator to complete one cycle, right? So we are saying from 0 degrees to 90 degrees to 270, okay, to 180, to 270, back to where it was, that gives us the complete revolution. Right? I'm sure you know that a complete revolution is 360 degrees. So what happens? We said at 0 degrees, there's no voltage generated. The conductor is in parallel with the field. Then at 90 degrees, the value is increased, right? Then at 180 degrees, so that's at 90. At 180 degrees, again, it's on the other side of the North Pole, but now in parallel, right? Then at 270, it's on the other side, but cutting at 90 degrees. Then at 360, it goes like that. Now you realize that this cycle, which is 360 degrees, also requires one revolution of the prime mover, right? So it also requires one revolution of the prime mover. Okay, so the prime mover should go through one revolution. So that revolution will also now give us the frequency, right? So when the AC general voltage current is in step with voltage, right? As the coil rotates 360 degrees, out of voltage grows through 1 cycle, the voltage will increase from zero to Emax, then decreases to a negative Emax, right? Then the period that we need now will be the time required to complete that one 360 revolution. So you realize that the frequency of the generated EMF F is equal to 2np over 120, right? Np over 120. So N now will be the number of poles on the machine. Now N is the speed of the rotor speed in the RPM, that revs per minute. Then P will be the number of poles in the machine divided by 120. In 120, we are just converting minutes to seconds and from poles to pole pairs, right? So you realize that there's a common expression which says that N is called 120F over P. This means you'll be interested in calculating the speed of rotation of the motor in terms of the motor. But for the generator, we are more concerned about the frequency of the generated EMF. That's why I realized that you need something to regulate the frequency of the produced EMF, because as the speed of rotation changes, you expect the frequency to also change, the frequency of the generated EMF, right? So you use this formula several times, but there is one tricky thing. If you use P as the number of poles, then you use 120. If you use P, maybe the small letter P, as the number of pole pairs, it means now P, right? P is the number of pairs, of poles. So this small p will be equal to P over two, right? So you should also take note of those changes. That is a P in terms of pole pairs, there's a P in terms of number of poles, right? We'll look at that later when we deal with the details of the calculations, but I'm just making you to take note of that. And also the speed will be in revs per minute, RPM. Those are the two most common errors that we have, what P stands for and what the value, the unit of the rotation speed of your motor. Then the peak voltage occurs at 90 degrees, right? And then the peak to peak will be the voltage between the crest and the trough. I'm sure you know that from our AC theory. So that's basically what we are looking at right now, right? That is what we are looking at right now. So in general, I just explained how an AC generator operates. So if you got the concept, the interaction between the magnetic field and the conductor due to the motion of the relative motion between the two, it explains the generation of AC. You realize that it also explains the movement of the conductor. That's why I used the AC generator as an example, because it covers everything. So you realize that there are a few things that will change from that basic machine which I was explaining, so that you can now understand what we do with in terms of our machines. So basically, I think that's our starting point. Then next week, we'll look at the DC machines, right? So here, I was just giving you an introduction to our machines, right? How the interaction between the field and the conductor produces an electric field in the generator. And you also realize that that's the same thing which produces motion, right? So we talked about Fleming's radiant rule as the generator principle. But you realize that if you reverse it, and let's say you know the direction of the current and the direction of the field, you realize that it can also give you the direction of motion of your conductor in the field, right? So I think we can stop here for today. Then next week, still on Thursday, because that's when we have our lecture. On Thursday, we have our lecture on DC machines, which is more detailed. I think that should be chapter 2 of the notes that I posted to you. So read those notes carefully, because I'll try to be a bit fast due to the issue of our time. I don't know if I have any questions before I close the meeting. You can unmute your audios if there's no other people in the background. Hello. Any questions? Okay, I'll just speak one person. Chadwobu. Any questions? Are you okay?
Yes.
Okay, that's fine. Who else? Very big. Maja?
No questions.
Okay. Mona Lisa? Any questions? So that the introduction that I have given you, and it will help you in understanding everything that we deal with in terms of machines. So realize that machines is just about the generated EMF, the motion, then everything will be converted to that, whether look at the power generated, the torque and the like, they still depend on those quantities. Right, so as of now, I'm sure you have finished reading chapter 1, because I'm also reading it so that if there are any questions, I would answer them. I don't know if there's anything difficult on chapter 1. So chapter 2, that's what we are going to cover next week in detail. Maybe we might need 2 sessions for that. Unless if you'll be giving another lecture. Okay? Right. Let's call it a day. Thank you.